We have a wonderful lunch panel. I'm not going to introduce the panel, but I do have the privilege of introducing the moderator of the panel, Dr. Christy Ebi of the University of Washington. Dr. Ebi is director of the University of Washington Center for Health and the Global Environment and is one of our co-hosts for this meeting today. She is also the Roman Haas Endowed Professor of Public Health Sciences at the University of Washington. She's worked with the WHO, UN Development Program, USAID, and other organizations, and has conducted 20 years of research and has practical experience on the health risks of climate. And I think she's the ideal person to lead our next discussion. So Dr. Ebi, come on up. Yes, yes.
Introduction. We are your lunch entertainment, so we're glad that many of you came back. You can see we have a slight complication here because one of our speakers could not participate. We have a video from him. I'll say a few remarks, tell you who's going to be on the panel, and then we'll have the video. I do have him on Skype so he can hear. He's live streaming the meeting, and we'll be able to answer any questions or offer his perspectives as we go forward. So as you know, that this is a panel on protecting health from climate-related risks. We're going to follow up on what you heard earlier this morning, and we're here with a much more positive message. We do have lots of challenges facing us in terms of the health risks of a changing climate. And we're going to talk about some of the actions that are being taken and some of the real benefits that we're seeing, particularly in the low and middle income countries. I'd like to emphasize comments that were made several times this morning. When we think about the health risks of a changing climate, it's not just climate change alone that drives those risks. Risks are a function of the hazards of a changing climate, but also the human and natural systems that are exposed to those hazards, as well as the underlying vulnerability. So you heard quite a bit this morning about vulnerability of different population groups in different regions. That means, therefore, that as we try to address these risks, that often addressing vulnerability in the short term is going to be as important as addressing climate change in the long term. We know that individuals, communities, and health systems have been coping with weather and climate variability throughout history. So we have long experience in how to manage some of the changes. Some we do relatively well, some we need to do a lot better on. But the rate of climate change, the magnitude and pattern of change are creating new challenges. In many ways, the low and middle income countries are leading the way. They are on the front line of the changes that are being observed. They're observing the impacts and they're taking action. I've had the privilege of spending quite a lot of the last 20 years in low and middle income countries, and it's inspiring to see what is going on even with limited resources. There's a lot more that needs to be done, but there is a lot that we can learn from in the US from what others have done. Our speakers are going to highlight some of the lessons that have been learned. Our first speaker is Dr. Diarmaid Campbell-Lendrum from the World Health Organization. We'll hear his video in a moment or two. Followed by him is Jan Semenza at the European Center for Disease Prevention and Control. And he's going to show how his group and ECDC has been leading the way on using climate and environmental information to protect public health in ways that we could have been doing over the last couple of decades. We've now got a real opportunity to take up the significant information that's become available from the geophysical sciences to improve all of our health. And then finally, Reiner Sauerborn is going to talk about some of the limits and opportunities for adaptation. He's from Heidelberg Institute of Public Health, and he will rely on his role as a lead author in the human health chapter of the last round of the IPCC. And so with that, I understand if I hit this button, we're going to see a video from Diarmaid. We'll see if this works.
Greetings from WHO in Geneva. Firstly, I'd like to commend the organisers for convening this critically important meeting. As soon as we were invited, we've done our absolute best to be there, but unfortunately, some of us are finding it's a little more complicated to get permission to visit your country than it was a few years ago. Nonetheless, I'm very happy to connect to you virtually. And we think we have some important messages from WHO. The first is that the people at this conference are absolutely not alone. The global health community recognises the fundamental threat that climate change presents to health. 10 years ago now, our Director General made her first major speech in the US, and she chose climate change as her theme. And in that speech, she identified climate change as perhaps the defining issue for public health during this century. And these connections are recognised not only by health professionals, but by those leading the response to climate change itself. The first principle of the Rio Declaration that gave rise to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, the first article of the convention itself, the first page of the 2015 Paris Agreement, all cite health as central to action on climate and environment. But we obviously need a plan if we're to respond to this responsibility that's been placed effectively on the health community. Following the Paris Agreement, WHO, together with the French and the Moroccan governments, invited the health community to a global conference in Paris, which aimed to reach some consensus on what that health and climate agenda should look like. And we basically came together around five priorities, which I'll briefly outline. The first priority is strengthening health resilience to climate change. You will already have discussed the wide range of ways in which climate change impacts health. And most countries, particularly the poorest and most vulnerable, identify health as a major issue. However, for the moment, health receives less than 2% of the international funds for adapting to climate change. And yet we have, in fact, years of experience in protecting health from climate risks. And we now have over 30 large-scale projects around the world specifically on health adaptation to climate change. That covers everything from making sure that water and sanitation systems in Ethiopia are resilient to floods and drought, to early warning systems for deadly heat waves in Chinese cities. So our most urgent priority is to scale up this investment with a particular focus on surveillance for climate-sensitive diseases and ensuring that the health sector itself is more robust to climate risks. The second of the five priorities is on promoting health as we cut carbon emissions. To take one example, air pollution now kills 6.5 million people a year around the world, which puts it right in the top rank of health risk factors. Much of this is from the same polluting and unsustainable energy sources that are driving climate change. The more that we can shift to clean and ideally renewable energy sources, or make it easier for people to walk or cycle to work, for example, the more we will reduce climate change, and we will also save lives immediately. So WHO now monitors air pollution around the world, and we are now assessing how many lives will be saved if countries keep to the commitments they have made to cut carbon emissions. The third priority is on the economics. To take one example, currently, societies don't include the massive health damages of polluting fuels in their price. The IMF considers that this is effectively a subsidy to dirty energy of over $5 trillion a year. And to put that in context, that is more than all governments around the world spend on healthcare. If countries put a price on carbon just in their own national interest, even excluding the benefits for the global climate, the IMF estimates that this would cut air pollution deaths in half and reduce carbon emissions by about 20%. So we want to work with other partners to promote a more coherent approach to valuing health and environment and avoiding these massive economic distortions. The fourth priority is continuing to mobilize the voice of the health community itself, which is among the most trusted and powerful voices there is. In the run-up to Paris, organizations representing, I think, around 10 million health professionals signed up to endorse a strong and health-promoting international climate agreement. US health organizations have always been at the forefront of this, and your engagement is now obviously more important than ever. So as WHO, we want to help bring your voice together with others around the world who are now also speaking up. The fifth and final priority is monitoring how well we're doing. What gets measured gets done. So we are now focusing much more on providing information that is directly relevant to protecting and promoting health at the national level. So we now produce country profiles on health and climate for over 40 countries, and I'm pleased to report that we're right now finalising the one for the US. These give information on climate hazards, on the associated risk to health, and increasingly on the health co-benefits of mitigation actions. And critically, they also track the positive steps that countries have already made. So in the US, this includes, for example, ratifying the UNFCCC and the Paris Agreement, but also actions directly relating to health, such as the Clean Power Plan, the launch of the CDC Climate and Health Programme, and the recent Climate and Health Assessment, all of which have shown real international leadership. So we're committed both to roll out these profiles to more countries and also to work with them to address the gaps that they identify in protecting health from climate risks. So those five priorities constitute our agenda for the coming years. Obviously, we can't do any of this alone, and we really look forward to working more closely with you. So thank you for your attention, and I wish you a hugely successful meeting.
Thanks very much. It's great to be back in the U.S. It's great to be here. Thanks for the organizers for inviting me. Vice President Al Gore, thanks for making this meeting happen. It's an honor to be here. I work at the European CDC. You see the headquarters right there, the red building in, on the left top corner. And I would like to follow up on the European tradition, as Sir Andy Haynes had started with, giving an optimistic perspective and trying to show us strategies that we can take to counter those challenges that are coming down the pipelines. Specifically, I would like to look at the impact of climate change on infectious diseases, of emerging infectious diseases, what those drivers are, and how we could potentially intervene to minimize the public health impacts of those emerging infectious diseases. We set out to identify the underlying drivers of emerging infectious diseases in a foresight study with experts like yourself, where we asked people what are these drivers that lead to an emerging of emerging infectious diseases, and we categorized them into three big categories. As you can see, global environmental change is one of them, social demographic change is another one, and then public health system. And those are the three big categories that we developed with our foresight study group, group of experts. And obviously within those three categories, there are subcategories, and climate change is one of them, climate change, but also environmental change, and then travel and tourism, migration, and global trade. So all those we grouped into that first category of global environmental change. Then in the second category, we have health inequalities and demographic change, aging of the population and so on, and then prevention and treatment and lifestyle issues like vaccine hesitancy and so on. And then in the third category, we have surveillance and reporting systems breakdowns, the failure of the surveillance system to pick up on certain signals that it should pick up, healthcare system structure changes, and animal health and food systems and so on. So those were the three big categories that we identified as drivers of emerging infectious diseases. And we asked ourselves the questions, how do they interact to cause the emergence of infectious diseases in Europe? And with an extensive literature review, we identified the certain scenarios that these drivers would cause to potentially overrun the public health system in Europe. And we recognized that these were the steps that need to be taken in order to intervene appropriately. But of course, this was a foresight study. So we used a crystal ball trying to anticipate the future. And all of you think that, well, you know, that's a very nice approach, but who can tell us whether this is the right thing to do and whether those are in fact the true underlying drivers? So we're trying to document the true underlying drivers of emerging infectious diseases in Europe in order to validate this study that we had done way back at the time. And what we did as a next step was to rely on data at the European CDC that we collect through epidemic intelligence. So we have a team of experts that review all infectious disease threats all over the world, whether it's a threat in Saudi Arabia, a threat in Brazil, or a threat anywhere in the world, and we try to assess that impact on Europe. And we relied on that database that had been collected over several years now and identify all the risk factors, determinants, and underlying drivers for every single infectious disease threat event in order to validate what we had come up here. And this is what the data look like. This one here is a dendrogram that we are familiar with in genetic research, where we relate the different drivers to each other, how they interact with each other to precipitate one of those infectious disease threat events. And on the very left side, you can see that travel and tourism stands out as the most significant driver of infectious disease threat events in Europe. There are other ones like global trade, but climate is on there. Climate is within the top five. the natural environment is another one. So those are important drivers when it comes to infectious disease threat events in Europe. And so the question I would like to throw out today, what can we do, given the fact that we now know what those drivers are of these infectious disease threat events in Europe, what are those drivers and how can we intervene on those? What can we do about it? Because we cannot sit back under the current circumstances where we're at with climate change to watch what's going on. And we have basically developed in Europe a system that works as follows. Let's say that climate change does in fact exist and it's not a Chinese hoax. And let's say that that leads to environmental consequences, and let's assume that that leads to direct exposures, heat waves. And in fact, I've been in this type of a field earlier on where we have looked at impact on extreme heat, on heat-related mortality and morbidity, but that's just only one of the health endpoints. Another one is infectious diseases. This one here is more indirect. It's more difficult to handle. But then we also have the impact on socioeconomic impact from climate change with migration and movements of populations due to drought and extreme weather events and so on. And all these lead then to health outcomes at the very end of this causal chain. And what do we do in public health? We monitor these health impacts at the very end of this causal chain. Guess what? At that point, it is too late. Is it possible to act upstream? Can we look at what's going on higher in this causal chain in order to have an impact? Can we monitor these epidemic precursors of disease? Can we potentially intervene on these epidemic precursors of disease? And that's exactly what we have done at ECDC. We have built a system that's called the European Environment Epidemiology Network, where we have amassed a wealth of environmental and climatic and social data that we can analyze in order to see whether there can be epidemic precursors of disease so we can intervene appropriately and have a bigger impact on the work that we do. Let me give you an example, and I had many examples. In fact, I could speak to every single driver that I had listed earlier, but due to the shortening of our talk, I will be only able to list two. Let's examine whether climate change had anything to do with climate change. And this one here illustrates data from NOAA, where they looked at the temperature, the land surface and ocean surface temperature percentiles in South America. And you can see that we have record heat or record warmth in the area where we experienced the Zika epidemic. We can in fact also look at precipitation extremes, and you can see these brown dots that illustrate an extreme heat, a drought event in September 2015, exactly at that time when the epidemic of Zika occurred. It turns out, as we had earlier, that temperature accelerates the replication of mosquitoes, the replication of the virus within the mosquitoes, increases biting rates and so on, and so temperature relates to these cold-blooded vectors, as we obviously know, but drought has an impact also. We all know that mosquitoes need water to replicate in their life cycle, but it turns out that if a drought hits this community, people bring their water containers into their households in order to save water for their daily activities. And what do mosquitoes do? They breed in those household containers. So now we have direct exposures of those mosquitoes in those households, and we believe there might have been a link to the Zika outbreak, as you can see over here on the third slide that's overlaid here, where we see this overlay, this relationship between extreme warmth, drought, and Zika. Obviously, this is very difficult to prove. The causal relationship is very hard to tease out, but there's obviously an association, and that's interesting to pursue. If we now consider climate change in origin country, we also might want to consider climate change in destination country. So on this particular slide here, we worked with Joachim Rocklöw at Umeå University, where we looked at all the flights that are coming in from Zika endemic areas into Europe. So that's the column on the left. You see the passenger volumes from Zika endemic areas into Europe. And you can see that we computed the reproductive number, which it gives you an indication of the likelihood of Zika transmission in certain areas of Europe. And obviously the southern part of Europe is particularly at risk, particularly in June, but even more so in July. and also in August when temperatures rise, and then it tapers off again in September. So we are in the process of building an interactive platform where we monitor all the flights that are coming in from Zika endemic areas and indicate areas that have an environmental and climatic suitability for this transmission in order to target surveillance activities for those areas that are at increased risk, where those passengers are coming in and where the climatic conditions are conducive for transmission. Let me show a very interesting slide. We also rely on data that from those islands where we had a Zika epidemic. And if you look at the blue curve, that is the incidence in the local, in this case, Guadeloupe and Martinique, where we have a Zika transmission. And that incidence rate relates to the incidence in passengers. So we have set up a surveillance system in Europe where we monitor all Zika cases that are coming in from all over the world. And it turns out that those incident cases over the passenger volume as a denominator allows us to compute the incidence, and they're highly correlated, as you can see on this slide here. So this work was done by Bertrand Souder at ECDC, and we can now identify the months where that peak is the highest, where we need to watch out when and where that risk is coming in, and we can take appropriate public health action. That's one of the examples. I could give you many more, but let me give you a waterborne example. As well. This one here is the E3 geoportal. So if you are online, put in E3 geoportal into Google, and you will pull up our big database of all the environmental data. And here we have a tool that monitors sea surface temperature and salinity in real time. The point of all this is to get a handle on the Vibrio infections. As was mentioned earlier today, Vibrio paramedicus and vulnificus are bacteria that grow in marine environments. They're part of the ecosystem under normal circumstances, but they start to bloom or they start to grow exponentially once the temperature passes 15 degrees Celsius. And we have now set up a system where we monitor the environmental conditions, salinity and temperature, worldwide, but this one here is now a Baltic. And you can see that the sea surface temperature increases in the month of July, and it reaches a threshold where we believe transmission is now a big issue, and these wound infections are of concern. So we monitor these conditions on a weekly basis, and we go out to public health professionals with a report and tell them we have currently environmentally conducive conditions for these Vibrio infections. You need to consider beach closures in this bay, in this estuary, or whatever that location is. So it's a proactive approach where we monitor these epidemic precursors of disease in order to prevent infections downstream. So we have, in fact, validated this data. We looked at the Swedish data, and guess what? There was, in fact, a peak in 2014. So we believe that our system that we have built to monitor sea surface temperature and salinity can, in fact, predict an epidemic signal. And we are now rolling this out, providing health officials with information that they need to take public health actions once we detect a signal like that. As I say, I could have talked about every single one of those drivers. These are just two to give you a flavor for where we want to go. And again, I would like to step in Sir Andy Haynes' footsteps to show you proactive, constructive solutions that we in the public health community can take to protect the health of the public from climate change.
Can you give me a green? Good afternoon and enjoy your dessert. I first have to thank Al Gore and all the organizers and the supporters of that meeting in difficult times. And I see it as a sign, a strong sign of resilience of American civil society and of science in times of adverse political climate change, let's call it. So, bravo. So adaptation, I was surprised that nobody really mentioned adaptation today. Are we missing an elephant in the room? Probably, I think, and that is also consistent with the literature. I will show you data on this, and I'm entitled to criticize science, gaps in scientific production, because I'm part of the scientific community. Adaptation is key for low and middle income countries. They are the most vulnerable. They have the least capacity to adapt, although they should adapt most, and we must help them. So there's almost no knowledge, no scientific publication on the effectiveness and on the cost of adaptation strategies. And this research and this evidence must be local and context specific. There's no model of adaptation. We saw a lot of world maps and so forth. Nobody can show a world map of adaptation. It has to be local, like in Atlanta, like in Delhi, like in the rural Burkina Faso. So this is why I chose the topic adaptation. And you see here a sugarcane cutter on the right and a lady in a sewing factory in a sweatshop, literally a sweatshop in Vietnam, working at the limits of their potential, of their physiological limits. But before I go into this, I wanted this topic, I wanted to step back a little bit and ask a slightly fundamental question. What is it that policy should take away as a message from science, health science? And not only policy, but also households, citizens. What's so important in health that we are making such a big deal about climate change and health? And you see, as many speakers, there's good news and there's bad news. Today we saw a lot of bad news, I must say, Andy, you were the with Al Gore, you were the only ones who said, well, but there are solutions and there are co-benefits. So the green part, and this is a shot from, I think, the Copenhagen COP conference there, this conference room, and in the middle, health, and to the right, you see the green, this is the good messages. Let's start on the top. That's the health benefits of climate. It's hard to read for me. Well, maybe my glasses or my age, I don't know. Health benefits of climate policy. These are the core benefits, and Andy, you did a great job of depicting and quantifying them. And the next one is, now I have to really turn around. The next one is, health is a motivator. Health is the argument that drives us to do something about climate, and not only citizens, households, but hopefully also politicians. Yes, nature and the beauty of nature and the preservation of the creation, these are motives, but health is the driving force. So if we want to change something, we have to touch people's hearts and not only their brains and with graphs and everything. So communicating this is very important, and health is the driver. Health is the human face of climate change. Where is Dean Williams? Well, Sheila. And at the bottom is, of course, any adaptation in poor countries is based on good basic health services. And this is missing. We've seen in the Ebola crisis what happens if you don't have functioning health services, but that's the cornerstone of all adaptation strategies. So these are the good things that comes with the topic of climate change. The red things are the, you can call them concerns, you can call them guardrails, you can call them also threats. I would call them guardrails because we can do something about it. And the one is the strong health damage, and we saw X presentations about, from infectious disease to heat to pollution. There's no doubt that there will be health damage. And the next one is the limits of adaptation from a health perspective, and that's what I'm going to talk about. Can we adapt them away? Because people are looking to us very often to support them in times of very big problems. I am a member of the International Physicians Against Nuclear for the Prevention of Nuclear War. And people, thank you. And people were looking to us white coats to, well, when it happens, you just distribute iodine pills and we'll be fine. And we had to say, no, we can't. We have to sort this problem out at the prevention level. So can we adapt the problem away? And of course, the answer is half, and I will talk about this. And the last thing on the right bottom is the loss of productivity, which may interest the World Bank or the finance ministers. There is a GDP loss due to decreased working capacity in outdoor settings, like building, like policemen, like farmers. Like non-air conditioned, and most factories in low-income countries are not air conditioned. So there is a GDP cut due to health, to physiology. And so this is maybe a kind of landscape in which I want to situate my talk on the limits of adaptation. We have seen this, and I want to go quickly through this. I could say ditto, but there is some difference here. The big pink line, the vertical line, is 2100. And all of the slides that I've seen today stop at 2100. This slide goes until 2300. And so you see what is a scenario. You see the four scenarios, they're the four different climate scenarios. What might look as a scenario that might keep the 2-degree limit turns out to exceed this limit afterwards. And look at the business as usual. I mean, the business as usual goes through the roofs to 12 degrees plus in 2300. That's what Andy called bequeathing a world to our kids and grandkids. And I have 4 kids and soon grandkids, and I don't want this to happen. So that is my motivation. It's a health argument. It's a generational argument that we must lead people to follow through. And we have heard this already, that in our health chapter we said, under this scenario, business as usual, which is unfortunately seems to be the scenario of the current government here, it is a world where large proportions will be uninhabitable, uncultivable land, and so forth. But I don't want to add the chorus of threats. I want to go into the adaptation. This is, and then I looked for a literature. Where's the literature on adaptation? This is the world map. You have seen these morphed maps of inequity, global inequity. There's inequity of impact, health impact, inequity of health resources, whatever. But there's also inequity of scientific production. We've heard examples from Europe, with due respect, from the US, but where's the literature on adaptation and on impact on climate change in these countries, in Africa and in South Asia there? It's very little, and this is for us to say mea culpa. We have to do something about this. The funding and the interest of research, it has to be directed to where the problems are. Oops. Oh. Well, I'm stealing my own thunder here. Can I? I can't reverse this. This is these curves. These are the low-hanging fruit, but it doesn't come in the way that I wanted. But look at the curve first. You see from the Rio agreement, and I guess Al Gore, you were there, the Rio 1992 to today, the production of scientific articles in PubMed. And you see the top one is extreme events. Of course, it's easier. Something happens, people die. We've seen at least 6 slides today on this. Of course, understandably. The next one is infectious diseases, also understandable. Then comes respiratory, and then comes a big gap, and then comes malnutrition, and then comes cardiovascular, and then comes non-communicable, and unfortunately mental health, if it's not for Lisa, is completely fallen off the radar screen for our researchers. So the good news is people are getting to their senses and are producing. The bad news is maybe not on the really, on all the relevant topics. Yes. And also not on adaptation. We didn't find a considerable amount of literature on adaptation. So let's go to the higher hanging fruit. It's very complicated, and we need to go to the adaptation research. Oops. Now.
The top.
Oh, the top one. See. And that was the our chapter of the IPCC report. And now we did the Delphi. We were 11 colleagues in the IPCC health chapter, and after sifting through these hundreds of articles, we said, what do we say about adaptation? So we said, okay, we have a score from 1 in the very bottom to 5 on the very top, and that is the maximum health impact. And what we can adapt away after having read all this, we have in red, so this reduction, and what is residual, what remains, is in yellow. And now comes a quick succession. That's under the current present climate change. May I remind you of the late Tony McMichael's adage, adaptation is managing the unavoidable, and mitigation is avoiding the unmanageable. It's brilliant, if you think about it. So we have to manage this already, and the climate change that we've already committed. And you see all these undernutrition, infectious diseases, and you see at the current state we are pretty good with maximum. We said, what can the world do? We can adapt it away. But in a 1.5 degree, well, you see this yellow part growing. I don't want to go into details here. And in a 4 degree world, it's getting out of control. So our message as health people must be, we can do a lot given maximum resources, But in a 4-degree world, even in a 2-degree world, there will be a strong residual impact, and that is an important, and it will mainly be in low-income countries. This is the whole together in our publication there in The Lancet. And there are two messages. For science, more research on the globally very different context of adaptation. For policy and the public, all of us, doctors cannot protect you from all climate change impacts. Above 2 degrees, it's extremely difficult. Above 4 degrees, it's impossible. And this is our target population, our children. And this is also an emotional message. We should take care of them because they are going to suffer through the mess that we are creating. Thank you very much.
You've clearly heard from the panel that we've got many opportunities in the next couple of decades to increase resilience of communities and of nations by using environmental information, by paying better attention to improving our health systems. And in the longer term, as Reiner just showed very clearly, the importance of mitigation, which we heard about a little bit earlier this morning. With that, I'd like to open up for questions. We've got bright lights in our eyes, so if people would please go to where the microphones are, and there's microphones upstairs. We have one question over here on my left.
Yes, I'm just gonna go ahead and ask it. There are groups of people in this country and in this world who would ask the question, so what about those people? Let them die. I know people who feel this way. They're voters, and they, you know, influence policymakers. And I wanna know, what do we say to them? As in survival of the fittest, baby. I feel that that is an elephant that's sitting on the roof here right now, because that feeling, I've heard it, it's astonishing and very distressing to hear, but it's out there.
Reiner?
Well, it's a very honest question, and I know that you are not, it's not your question, it's a question that you hear, and I heard it too, I must say. And the answer is, of course, this is a world you cannot put frontiers. Let's look at the Syrian crisis. The Syrian war erupted after 3 years of consecutive drought, which is three times as likely under climate change scenarios than without climate change scenarios. So, and they are coming to Germany. We've taken in 1 million of them. So you cannot say we are safe, even on a health, on a very short-sighted health perspective. You see the wildfires, California, you see Zika coming. It is not possible. It may be that in poor countries there will be more impact, that's unfortunately true. And so that would be my response, but my first response would be, what moral fabric do you have? I mean, how can you say I don't care? That's another story. I would just attack this straight on the moral and value base, and then say, even if you are so mean, you cannot hide. They will get you. Climate change will get you.
I'd like to add to that that people in the U.S. right now are suffering and dying from climate change. We see it in our news. We heard the presentations this morning. And so not caring about them is also not caring about us, and not caring about our children. And it goes back to Reiner's question of what kind of moral fabric is that, that we only concerned about our individual well-being and not of future generations, not of our neighbors, the people who are dying in heat waves, the people who are gonna be affected by undernutrition in this country by changing nutritional quality of food, by the emerging disease threats that we heard from Jan that are coming into our own doors. So it is in our best interest to make sure that we protect our own health and the health of others, just from the perspective of why should I care, but on a broader perspective of our humanity, we should care about what we have caused in other countries and what the impacts they are personally feeling because of the actions we've taken. One comment I haven't heard so far today is that when you spend time outside the U.S., and I'm fortunate I get to spend a lot of time outside the U.S., climate change is a whole of government issue. If the U.S. wants to achieve particular policy aims, it's gonna talk with countries who has climate change as their number one policy goal. And so it's not just confined within a Ministry of the Environment. This is a comprehensive kind of issue. Take a question over there, and do we have anybody?
Hi, John Cataldi from Native American Venture Fund. First, a comment. This is my first climate health meeting gathering, and I must say, thank you so much to esteemed panelists, former Vice President Al Gore and the Turner Foundation for putting on such a fantastic event. My second is, from a standpoint of crossing the chasm between your research and knowledge and the accumulation of other scientific minds such as yourself to creating public policy, what's that chasm that has to be crossed? And what are the steps to cross that chasm to bring the reality of climate change to those that actually enact?
The strategy that we are taking is to circumvent the policy aspect altogether and to take public health action that have an impact on those susceptible and vulnerable communities. So we are trying to develop systems that minimize that impact. That is not to say that policy isn't important, but I think it's important to remember that we need to run on two tracks simultaneously. Climate change is here, it's here to stay, we need to take action now. And even if you want to consider future policy options, steps that we can take today will have an impact on public health right now. So there are definitely steps that we can do to have impacts.
And I'll bring up an issue that Dermot raised and other people raised. There has been 20 years of raising awareness around the world about the health impacts of a changing climate, and that has produced a real change in awareness, particularly within ministries and departments of health. They have policies, they're ready to enact policies. We have almost no funding. So you heard of $1.2 billion in adaptation funding, 2% has gone to health. If you look at the research that's being funded, Jan and I just published something a few months ago about how much research is being funded in this area, it's almost nothing. So there's not the political commitment to make sure that the resources that are needed to show the kinds of advances Reiner showed that we could make are being made available. So it's less about policy than it is about making sure that we have those resources that we need. And it's both human and financial resources.
Can I chip in with a positive note? Not that yours was negative, but how do you know that policy makers take into account what you're saying and publishing? That's a key question for us who want to be actionable, you know, what we're doing. And one idea that we had, we look at the text of EU legislation, and later we expanded it to 99 countries legislation on climate change, which had the word health and health impact and health adaptation in there. And now, lo and behold, it increased dramatically before the COP21. And of course, that was when everything was in the air and where we tried to launch MOOCs and we tried to publish things, you know. So I think we do have an impact. It's a kind of trickle down. It's not like immediate. But the more you talk, you go to COP conferences like we all do. We are in IPCC, which is all governments. It's not a United Nations panel. It's government, intergovernmental panel with 8,000 scientists of the entire world. So that these are the interfaces. And then there's the teaching. We have to win young minds over to think about these things in undergraduate courses and you name it, and go to schools and go to businesses and so forth. So I think that's the way communicating the issue is the way to have an impact, not sitting on your data.
We've got a question up there, but I'm gonna read a response from Dermot. He says, policy movement depends mainly on public support. We've seen it on smoking, we're starting to see it on air pollution. We can see it on climate change as well. There's some real leadership, the Paris Agreement, we heard about the cities, making sure that clean air and climate change are being addressed. They're aware that they're the same issue. So we can bring it to people's attention, and we're doing it through this meeting. So thanks again to all the organizers and all the co-sponsors for this, because we want to make sure that this is on people's agenda, just like we don't like to see our kids choking from asthma during an air pollution episode. We have a question up top. No, we don't? Somebody had a question. They sat down. So I'll go back to my left.
Thank you for your leadership. I'm Emily York, and I coordinate the state of Oregon's climate and health program, which is made possible by the CDC's climate and health program. And I've had the opportunity to connect with a number of other counterparts across the nation, and we're tasked with addressing all of these many issues that we're talking about today. And what we know in public health is that often where we have the most impact is in partnering with others in other sectors. And so my question for you all is, what is your guidance there in terms of having, you know, little capacity and a lot of different areas that we could be doing this work? What is your guidance for kind of figuring out where are the greatest opportunities for partnering and prioritizing those partnerships to have the biggest impact in advancing our climate and health goals?
Isn't it wonderful to be in a situation where there's so much opportunity to make a difference? And we are in that situation, and you're absolutely right, the partnerships are critical. The choices typically that have been made are the partners first with people who are working on environmental issues. So particularly with your meteorological services, they're always eager to help. They are really quite interested in making sure that the kind of work that they do is uptaken by the health sector and is useful for the health sector. And from there, broadening out, that there's partnerships across most ministries in most countries to try and make sure you have those interconnections. Did you want to, Jan?
Just from my personal experience, I've changed my career so many times, I don't even remember. I was trained in one completely different field. I've ended up over here. I've done pretty much everything under the sun, and I've enjoyed it. So I've always identified those problems and issues that interest me and then pursue them. And one of the projects that I encountered was, in fact, in Portland, in Oregon, where we work with the community to build community resilience, to increase adaptive capacity within the community to counter those climate stresses that are coming down the pipelines. So I think the low-hanging fruit, the important partner, has to be the community. And I immerse myself into this community where there was a lot of urban blight, a lot of urban stressors, and a lot of social issues, and we engaged the communities to build social capital to address those changes. And by intervening in the built urban environment, by having people work together in a voluntary community activity program or activities, we were able to turn things around. And me as an epidemiologist, I documented a change from before and after by showing that we could increase the sense of community, the social networks. We documented a decrease in depression, increase in social capital by engaging communities around those activities and trying to increase the community capacity and resilience against these climate stressors. So for me, my passion would be to work with communities on the ground to have a direct impact.
See, we've got several people, so we've got three people queued up for questions, and I think we'll have to cut it off at that.
Quick question, Laurie Garrett from the Council on Foreign Relations to Jan. Fantastic to see the ECDC model, and it's really exciting. The thing that I'm concerned about is, having spent time in Siberia, Iceland, Svalbard, et cetera, I'm very concerned about the emergence of microbes out of frozen permafrost, the recent 10,000 dead reindeer of Siberia, for example, the mass die-off in Saiga, of Saiga populations in Kazakhstan. And in Iceland, they have discovered Vibrio cholera is a permanent feature of intertidal waters. But because of the very short summer period, it's not a threat to human health at this time. And I wonder if you can plug in your ECDC models some ways of looking at microorganism release from existing ecologies, not importations, but due to subtle permutations in either acidity or absolute temperature that could result in things like the Pandora virus released in Siberia or the upcoming viral releases expected out of Greenland.
Yeah, good question. And you're all familiar with this issue of the known unknown and the unknown unknowns, right? And I don't want to say who quoted it, who said that, but I don't pretend that we have the crystal ball and that we can see into the future. Nobody would ever anticipated SARS or HIV or any one of these pathogens that emerged on the horizon and completely overran the public health infrastructure and had a catastrophic impact on our societies. So I don't pretend that we can do that. The system that we have built is trying to monitor environmental conditions that are precursors of these epidemics, and that's what we're trying to do. It will take a lot of data mining big data strategies to tackle those kind of issues. Unfortunately, we are underfunding surveillance systems, we are underfunding public health, so our capacity will be diminished, but nevertheless, it's an important concern, but I don't pretend that I would be able to predict anything like that, nowhere close, just as a reality check.
Hi, I'm Dr. Steve Hansen. I'm a physician from California. Long history of activity against the tobacco companies. The people that really do listen to your data are the fossil fuel flacks and those who give them money and buy access in their institutes of policy and so on and so forth. These people are war criminals in the war against climate change, the biggest war we've ever been in. They're child abusers. They need to be called out on, in every sense. The people who say there isn't climate change, or that we can adapt to it, or that it isn't a big deal, or we don't really know where it's coming from, those people all need to be called the bald-faced liars and psychopaths they really are, for taking the money and for doing what they're doing to the climate and the people and the kids. And I have some hope that the lawsuit in Oregon on behalf of the 21 children there and James Hansen will proceed and shine a little more light on this, but let's not pussyfoot around this. I talked to every Surgeon General about how they were, you know, from Coop on down, how they were suppressed by the public health apparatus. My local people over the years get suppressed by, what, three people on the Board of Supervisors or something. You know, let's stick up your stick up public health for what you know is right. Don't cancel conferences. Thank you.
Can I make a comment?
Go ahead.
Thank you very much for this very strong statement, which is obviously close to the truth. And but this, I was raised in public health with the war on tobacco. And there the situation was clear. You had the tobacco industry. They were so well organized, the Merchants of Doubt, you know this book, you know, they commissioned research, they stalled, they did everything. You can learn from their strategies in our fight against the climate deniers, you know. But the situation, the playing field is different. You have now, for example, the windmill, Al Gore mentioned that windmill producers, you have BMW producing, you have Tesla, you have half of the industry, or two-thirds maybe, who are winners if they do it right. And then you have the fossil industry, which is very powerful, and particularly powerful in your current administration. And they, of course, are stalling, they're doing all the tactics that Marlboro and that the tobacco industry did. But working with the others and not discarding industry as a wholesale sort of they are bad would also not help. So let's talk to those who are gaining, doing windmills, doing photovoltaic, and building, retrofitting homes. We've seen a lot of possibilities today where also the industry can gain and we can bring them into the fold rather than seeing them as adversaries.
And with that, I'd like to really thank the, could you thank the panel? Because we've got another voice we'd like to hear.
What a wonderful panel, and Dr. Ebi, thank you for doing such a great job of moderating it. Thank you so much.